Getting ready.
Yes.
Oh, they are ready, actually. And you see here, I think people are coming in now. It's on top of the hour, so everybody get ready. I'm going to put the recording on. And for this one, I am recording in two different sessions. So it's the first session and then the second session, I hope. I'm putting my second one on. And I would love for everybody to mute except for Theresa. Please, everybody mute. I can also mute everybody, of course. Manage. Mute all. I'll mute everybody. Now I have muted everybody. And let's see. We'll just open up Theresa and unmute Theresa. There you go, Theresa. Now I have unmuted you and muted everybody else.
Okay, hello. Awesome. Yeah.
And I'm just going to say, I want to welcome Theresa Wright. And I must say it's an honor for me to have Theresa on board with this training. Theresa has the longest time as a professional working with food addiction amongst other addictions, and a lot of, in my opinion, a lot of strengths and a lot of spiritual strengths that I've drawn from, and it's been wonderful to have her as a backland in my work. So thank you, Theresa, for coming, and I invite you all to listen to the expert on food plans. Here you go.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm going to start by saying, first off, I have a bachelor's and a master's in nutrition from Drexel University. I'm a registered dietitian and a licensed nutritionist. I started working with food addicts very much by accident in 1989. And so a lot of what I'm going to tell you today is what I've learned by working with food addicts for the last 28 years. In 1989, Glen Bay Hospital was still active, and I began to work with a woman who did aftercare for Glen Bay Hospital of Tampa, and she taught me a great deal. And in the process, I began a private practice. And I've been doing this for many years, but at that time, nobody really believed that food addiction really existed. What they said was, you can't be addicted to food because you have to eat. And what I think is, alcoholics don't stop drinking, they stop drinking alcohol. Food addicts have to stop eating, not all food, but the foods they're sensitive to. So the first thing I want to talk about is what makes a food plan effective. Now, I think a food plan is supposed to be a gentle worksheet that you use to manage your daily food. It's the difference between a pair of your comfortable sneakers and a pair of 4-inch high heels. A diet is a pair of 4-inch high heels that happens right before you gain 20 pounds. And a food plan is that comfortable pair of sneakers that lets you walk through hell and high water without slipping and falling. So what I think makes a food plan effective, and I'm going to be very specific about a lot of these things, but please be welcome to interrupt me if you don't understand something, or if I'm not clear, or you have a question. The thing that makes a food plan effective is, first off, it's enough. A diet is a period of restriction. A diet means that I don't have enough, and I'm hungry all the time, and I'm struggling to maintain it. And I want my food plans to be enough food that the person is comfortable. I want it to be easy for the person to follow because I want it to fit the way their lifestyle is. I want it to meet their nutrient needs. I think this is the most important piece of this. If we don't meet the body's nutrient needs, the body's going to fight us tooth and nail for more food. I see that a lot when people have cut out groups of foods and not replaced the nutrients that they would have gotten from those foods. The body is uncomfortable and struggling, and that makes staying off your binge and drug foods much more difficult. And I have to set up the food plan to prevent the behaviors that we want to avoid. I don't want people binging or purging or starving or restricting. I want the food plan to be set up in a way that helps them prevent that. If we believe that food addiction is a physical disorder, and I do, I think it's a physical, genetically inherited, biochemical hook in the way the body processes man-made and processed foods. So I want to take out all of the binge and drug and trigger foods and all of their friends. In other words, if you're sensitive to potato chips, you're going to be sensitive to corn chips. You're going to be sensitive to split pea chips. You're going to be sensitive to lentil chips. You're going to be sensitive to veggie chip because it's that floury, chippy, salty thing that is what's triggering you. So I have to take out all of the binge and drug and trigger foods and all their friends. And then I think some of the time, I live in Pennsylvania in the United States. In Overeaters Anonymous is not really strong in my area. And a lot of times what they do is they spend time arguing about what you should eat on your food plan, and they focus only on the food plan. And my point is we set a food plan and then we do a recovery process. This is not the be-all. The food plan is not the be-all and the end-all. The food plan is the beginning. And then we get the people far enough into the food plan that they're comfortable. And then we get them into the recovery process and we let them do the recovery process, which sets them free. Let's talk about what addictive foods are. I tell people if the food didn't exist before man built a factory in which to make it, don't eat it. They are refined and processed and man-made foods. David Kessler, who used to be the chair of the United States Food and Drug Administration, says they're edible food-like objects. They look like food, they taste like food, but really they're not food. They're made in a factory to look like food and to earn a lot of money. It annoys me immensely to know that our big food manufacturers have whole departments of people whose job it is to find the cheapest way to make a food so that you would like it and want more of it. And it upsets me immensely to notice that R.J. Reynolds, the cigarette manufacturer, has bought up Kraft Foods. And slowly cigarette manufacturers, I have to do more research on this, but cigarette manufacturers are buying processed big food companies. And so we're going to see more of this issue in the United States. The addictive foods are foods the client obsesses about and eats to excess. I have a client who has a thing about pizza, and we had to take out cheese and flour from her food plan because her best and biggest binge food was pizza. Well, she went to Wegmans, which is a very high-end food store here, and bought some special pepperoni because she thought that was fine because it wasn't pizza. Well, guess what? It became a food that she obsesses about and kept going back to the refrigerator for more. So we want to take out the foods that stick in the client's mind and the client obsesses about and eats to excess. And we want to take out all the foods that smell and look and taste like the addictive foods. So the pepperoni my client bought was turkey pepperoni, and it had no nitrates and no preservatives and no sugar added to it. So it was supposed to be a wonderful, perfect pepperoni, but it looks, tastes, and smells like the pepperoni on her pizza, so it triggered her. And usually, addictive foods are high-calorie and nutrient-free. They're not the high-nutrient foods that the body needs. They're the low-nutrient foods that we want to munch on. Does anybody have a question or comment so far? No, you're all quiet.
Teresa?
Yes?
I have a comment, because I say about myself, if I was desperate, I would binge on weeds in the garden, okay? And so I think from what I've seen in my own history and also what I've seen with other people is, yes, these addictive foods, I agree 100%, but then there's the behavior of even binging on, I've heard people share at meetings that they binge on abstinent foods. So how would you look at that?
Every item inserted into the oral cavity can become a binge food for a compulsive eater. And you have to look at what it is that is the binging, what it is that is going on here. Are we having a feeling? Are we looking for something that's different from what we usually eat? Are we looking for a particular taste or texture? So you have to look at what's happening with the rest of the recovery program and see what is really going on.
I have a question too, Teresa. Thank you. It's Mary. And what about someone who's volume addicted, who you say it has to be enough, but nothing is ever enough?
Yes, they just want more. I have a client who says that, I don't care what it is, I just want more. And that's one of the things. If I go on here to the next slide. Here's a list of the foods that could be addictive. Sugar. All forms of sugar. I'm rewriting my sugars list because I'm up to 130 sugars. Flours of all kinds. But if you look on the right-hand side of the column, you'll see volume, just more. And I think one of the things that happens here is there's a hormone made by the stomach that tells the brain that I've had enough. And for some people, that hormone doesn't work. And for some people, they have to get their bodies, their bellies really full because they've stretched out their stomach so much from the binging that they can't, they don't feel satisfied until the stomach is really full, because that's when the hormones are released that tell the body that you're full. And some of the time, they never feel full. And that's the purpose of weighing and measuring. Okay? Anyone else? Okay, now, the next slide here is foods to eliminate. I don't want to eliminate all these foods all the time. What I have to do is I ask the client to tell me, when she's having a good binge, what's a good binge food for you? It could be ice cream. It could be pastries. It could be potato chips, salt and salty foods. It could be caffeine and other stimulants. If it's not chocolate, it's not worth the calories. I have clients who binge on Equal, which is NutraSweet. NutraSweet comes from two amino acids that affect brain chemistry. If you look at the label of NutraSweet, you'll see it says phenylketonurics cannot have this. That's because NutraSweet is made from two amino acids that affect the brain, that cross the blood-brain barrier and affect the brain functioning. So I don't recommend NutraSweet for anyone. Sugar substitutes are, again, because we're really sensitive to sugar in the first place, something that looks and smells and tastes like sugar can really be triggering for people. I have clients who pour sugar substitutes in their on their tongue and use 70 a day. Yet at the same time, it may be something that the client wants, and I'll talk about that in a minute. And I'm always looking at the textures, because creamy, crunchy, and chewy are the textures that people are looking for in their binge and drug foods. When I come back to looking at a person's sugar, I want to know, what kind of sugar are we having? Are we having gummy bears? Are we having regular soda? What kind of sugar is this? And yeah, Esther Helga will be sending you a list of sugars, and I'm in the process of revising it and practically doubling it. And because we keep getting more and more sugars into the system. But I think one of the most powerfully strong sugars is high fructose corn syrup. When I give, they did a study, and they gave rats the choice of sugar water or regular water, and the rats chose sugar water, which is fine. Then they gave the rats the choice of high fructose corn syrup or water, and the rats chose high fructose corn syrup instead of water. That's appropriate. Then they gave the rats the choice of sugar or high fructose corn syrup, and they chose high fructose corn syrup. And then they gave the rats the choice of high fructose corn syrup or cocaine, and the rats chose high fructose corn syrup. And when the high fructose corn syrup was withdrawn abruptly, the rats had seizures and withdrawal symptoms, just like they would from cocaine. So I think high fructose corn syrup is one of the most dangerous sugar analogs in the world. It's very cheap. It has a very good texture in processed foods. It keeps people from noticing that there's sugar in the product, because it doesn't have a powerful sugar taste, but it has a powerful texture. And the people who go for creamy textures are going to go for high sugar, high fructose sugar. Sugar alcohols are a molecule of sugar and a molecule of alcohol. Now, if you're an alcoholic, do you think you could be sensitive to a sugar alcohol? And if you're a sugar addict, I think you're going to be even more sensitive to sugar alcohols than you would to sugar. They are powerful. And the problem is, now, I don't know about in Iceland, but in the United States, only sugars on the label, only sugars are recorded on the label as sugars if they cause dental cavities. Well, high fructose corn syrup doesn't cause dental cavities. And there are lots of other sugars that don't cause dental cavities. So they're listed on our food labels as other carbohydrates, not as high fructose corn, not as real sugars. So we have to be careful about sorbitol, mannitol, xylitol, erythritol, inulin, maltitol. These are all sugar alcohols. The next two are the most difficult. They're flours of all kinds. When I use white flour, I take away the bran, the germ, and all of the nutrients from the whole grain product.
Theresa, can I interrupt you a little bit? Is there somebody talking in your background? Because it's like somebody, I think everybody is muted, which is on the call, but would everybody check that? Because it seems to be somebody talking in the background.
Let me just double check.
Okay, thank you.
Sandra has one line open and one line closed.
Oh, okay, Sandra, are you?
No, I'm muted. I think you're looking at my laptop that ran out of battery.
Ah, okay.
Another laptop. Plus, I'm in a very quiet condo. I'm here by myself.
Okay, thank you. Probably Theresa needed to lock the door onto somebody at home. I'm sorry about that, Theresa.
Voice.
And if you would really talk well into the computer, just so that we may be able to hear you a little bit clearer, but you're okay. But if you'd be a bit closer, it would be better, I think. Thank you.
Thanks for telling me.
Yeah.
I've been dreading talking about flours. Wheat and gluten and grains and flours are this discussion in a lot of pieces of Overeaters Anonymous in America today. When I take a kernel of wheat, it has a lot of protein, it has a lot of B vitamins and minerals, it has a lot of fiber. It's got 18 B vitamins and 4 minerals. That, if I grind it into a powder, that's whole wheat flour. If I take off the bran, which is the tough outer hull, and the germ, I can sell that as Red Dog, it's hog food. When I do that, I'm taking off all of the B vitamins, all of the minerals, all of the oil, all of the protein. And what's left is the endosperm. It's entirely starch. Starch is 50 to 1,000 molecules of sugar hooked together. In the 1800s, when Billers first learned to do that, the rich people started using the white flour. And in 3 months, all the rich people had B vitamin deficiency diseases because they had lost their source. In America today, we have enriched wheat flour. And that's white flour. And we've added back 3 vitamins and 1 mineral in an amount that will protect us from getting B vitamin deficiency diseases. Because when the rich people started eating the white flour, in 3 months they all had B vitamin deficiency diseases because they lost their source. So my first question is, if I'm going to take out enriched wheat flour, I have to look at where I'm going to get B vitamins from. The second thing is, white flour, 52,000 molecules of sugar hooked together. How rapidly do you think the body can absorb that and call it sugar? The average American pasta serving is 3 cups. It's all white flour. That's the equivalent of 6 slices of bread. We eat too much of it altogether. Our portion sizes are way bigger than we need to have them. And white flour is in everything. So it's very difficult for us to know how to get rid of all of, and which of these products to get rid of. Because the next one is wheat. Now, I don't believe that God and Mother Nature would have made something that the body couldn't tolerate and call that food. But I think that if I look at, there's a book called Wheat Belly. And one of the things it says is that our genetically modified wheat is so different from the wheat that God and Mother Nature planned that we can be sensitive to the GMO wheat, but not sensitive to real wheat. So there's a question. The third question is gluten. Gluten is a protein found in the wheat kernel. And we've heard so much about celiac disease in the last several years. Is it that the client is sensitive to gluten? Because if it's gluten, that means wheat, rye, oat, and barley. And we have to be really careful because gluten contamination is easy. If a truck carries wheat to the processing plant today and tomorrow carries gluten-free oats to the processing plant, if the wheat product is still in the truck, it contaminates the wheat, the oats, so that now we have oats with gluten, which have gluten in them. So we have to get gluten-free oats. And then there is the whole question of grains. Some people are so sensitive that they're sensitive to all grains, and some people are not sensitive to grains, but are sensitive to wheat. People can be sensitive to flour, to wheat, to gluten, to grains, or to all four. And we have to look again at what is the product that causes the cravings and obsessions. Sometimes it's one, sometimes it's none, sometimes it's all four. I have to look at that carefully. The next thing, oh, and the other thing, I was talking to another dietitian who works with bariatric people, and he says that after bariatric surgery, we have to be careful not to give products that expand in the stomach, because the stomach has been shrunk by the bariatric surgery. So we have to look at what is going on with the person as a whole person as we set up the food plan. The next food to eliminate is fat and fatty foods. there's an article in New York Times that said that some researchers at Baylor University were paid off to say that it is fat that causes sugar, that causes heart disease rather than sugar. And so we've been being really careful about fatty foods. And that's important and a good thing. But the body needs some fat. And we have to be careful about where is the fat. Is it that the person is eating French fries, Ben and Jerry's, which is a very high-fat ice cream? What is the fatty food that we're using, and what are we combining it with? I have clients who will eat mayonnaise out of the jar. I have clients who will eat butter out of the jar. But they can eat two gummy bears, which are all sugar, and walk away. So is it fat, or is it fat in combination with sugar, or is it fat in combination with sugar and flour? We have to kind of sort that out by listening to what is the client's binge food. The next one is salt and salty foods. Americans eat 6 to 8 times as much salt as they need to eat. And salt provides a particular response in the body that involves holding on to fluids and affecting brain chemistry. So we have to be teaching the clients to use garlic and onion and other herbs to season their food. And I'll talk about that more. The next one is dairy products. And there's a lot of discussion about dairy products. Some of us say that people in Mesopotamia ate dairy and it's fine. Others of us say that there are morphine-like substances in dairies. And the first group says, oh, they're digested in the stomach, and they are. But my question is, if I have someone with a creamy texture addiction, is her addiction to eating 4 cups of yogurt creamy, or is it dairy? And I have to look at knowing which one it is. And the last one I want to talk about is caffeine and other stimulants. I found out just yesterday, I'm doing a food plan book, and I found out as I was doing my research that the caffeine in diet soda and the energy beverages is synthetic caffeine, and that the caffeine in decaf can be synthetic, and that the real caffeine is in coffee. Now, the real coffee, a lot of people can tolerate 1 or 2 cups of real coffee, but if I give them decaf, they're going to eat the whole pot, and if I give them diet soda, they're going to drink a gallon. And I think that's not the caffeine, but the synthetic caffeine. The caffeine withdrawal is really big. Some of the time what I do is I ask people to just hold off on the caffeine withdrawal until we've gone through a withdrawal with other things, because some of the time the caffeine withdrawal is too big. And most of the research says that less than 5 cups of caffeine is not harmful. So if the person is drinking 1 or 2 cups of caffeine, I tend to let that go until we get the rest of the stuff straightened out. But that's just my opinion. Do you have questions?
Yes, this is Agnes. I have a question.
Hi, Agnes.
Hi. I'm just wondering about the starch. You haven't mentioned the maize and the rice and the potato starch.
Yes.
It's not on the list. why are you just interested in the sugars?
Sugar is the big thing.
I know.
And I find that if people get off the sugar and the flours, we can then look at the starch. If we are looking at starches, there are different kinds of starches, and I'm in the middle of doing a bunch of research on this. There are some starches that people are more sensitive to, and some starches that people are not sensitive to. If it causes cravings and obsessions, take it out. If it doesn't, can we leave it in? Especially if a person is interested in, I have a woman who is doing a triathlon. She needs some kind of carbohydrate to do the triathlon with. So we have to balance that out. Some of us say that we have to take out all the starches. And if that's what the person needs, that's what the person needs. I tend to try with the starches in, because in America, it gives a more natural food plan. It makes it more comfortable for people to eat. And if they can eat half a cup of rice, and if they can eat half a cup of quinoa or millet, then that's fine with me. And the body uses that for energy. So we have to have a balance here. Are you having people with trouble with starches?
Well, I was abusing maize and potato starch for good. It was just my food. I just eat potatoes and maize, then I didn't have to eat anything else.
Maize is corn in English, Agnes.
Oh, corn. Sorry.
Popcorn
and potatoes. That was my food.
We've talked about high fructose corn syrup. The reason you're sensitive to corn is that carbohydrate in corn. And corn probably should go on this list. The high fructose corn syrup is one of the most powerful triggers in the world. So I'm not surprised that corn is a problem for you. But a question for you. When you put in your protein and your vegetables and your fat, are you safe with half a cup of rice or quinoa?
I wouldn't take the risk.
Okay. That's actually
I can answer that. I would dive in the popcorn bowl.
Yeah,
I have a question about nuts. You don't have nuts on here. Is that something that you found as a challenge or free?
It's a challenge for some people, but it's not one of the most common allergens. And I tend to start this as a process. I want to get the person moving towards the major issues, and I want to get individualized. Now, popcorn. In 30 years, I have 3 people who can handle popcorn. I don't know why. Popcorn is supposed to be a whole grain. Popcorn is supposed to be just fine, but I think it's the crunchy texture and the salty texture of the popcorn that does it for people.
Teresa, this is Judy. You have flours of all kinds. I don't happen to feel that flour is created equal. I mean, I really think there are differences because I can't handle white flour, wheat flour, but I can handle soy flour. Doesn't affect me at all.
Uh-huh.
So I just putting that, but I do understand it's foods to eliminate could be. I understand. Because everybody's different.
Everybody is different. You hear nothing else from me today. Hear that everybody is different. Nobody takes out all the foods on this list, I don't think. Some people may have to. But I just want to take out the ones that you're going to dive into head first.
I had a question.
If you're going to dive into head first, take it out. And if you can tolerate soy flour, Judy, that's a blessing. Call that a blessing and go on.
Teresa, I had actually 2 questions. One about dairy. So I'm going to use my own experience. So yogurt really, I don't even enjoy yogurt, but cheese really lights me up. So do you make a distinguish between yogurt and then cheeses, hard dairies?
Absolutely. Okay. Because cheese has protein and fat. And a very relatively high fat. Dairy has protein, some fat, and some carbohydrate. So they're really different foods.
Mm-hmm.
They're different physical components, and they're different nutrition components.
Cheese has salt too, right?
I'm sorry?
Cheese also has salt.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And the other question I had was around coffee. And so I'm really on the fence about it. I try to keep coffee out of my diet unless I'm having a really tired day. I didn't sleep the night before and I really need that cup of coffee to get through the day. But I'm always worried that if I have coffee, I'm setting myself up to crave food. Is that true? Is there any connection between the two?
I don't think so. Hmm. Do you crave food when you have coffee?
No, I just have guilt because I've been told in this 12-step world that I should not have coffee, period. You just shouldn't have it. And so every time I do indulge in a cup of coffee and it only has milk in it, I feel tremendous guilt. and I'm waiting for the cravings to start, but they don't.
Give up the guilt.
Okay.
If the cravings and the obsession don't start and you're drinking a reasonable amount, then consider it a gift.
Okay.
That you can do that 1 cup or 2 cups a day. If you can do that and it works for you, it's fine.
Thank you.
I have a question, please.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Hi, Teresa. This is Dima.
Hi, Dima.
Hi. I wanted to ask you, since we all know that according to the American Dietetic Association, that 50 to 55% of our balanced diet should be from carbohydrates. So what kind of carbohydrates are we allowed to take? Since we are not allowed to take milk and yogurt, neither wheat or grains, we only have fruits left. So this is what is allowed, because usually people will need bread in any kind of bread or any kind of flour or any kind of grain. So can you answer that, please? Thank you.
You're welcome. People who are food addicts have a specific physical disorder, and we don't follow the American Dietetics Association food plan for the people who are food addicts. You need a high protein, low carbohydrate diet. That doesn't mean no carbohydrates, but it means a lower carbohydrate diet, and you want to find a balance of the carbohydrates that works for you. And I tend to go with about 40% carbohydrates.
From which sources?
Five.
From which sources the carbohydrates? From fruits only?
From fruits, from any grain that person can tolerate, and from milk and yogurt.
From milk and yogurt, we can have it?
The person can have it.
Okay, thank you.
Uh-huh.
Teresa. This is Cindy Myers Morrison. Thank you. It's very interesting to hear all of this, and I appreciate your sharing. There are carbohydrates in a lot of vegetables. So when we're eating vegetables, we're getting carbohydrates. Also, the high fructose is not just about high fructose corn syrup, but also about large amounts of fruit in the eating. That the liver is what processes fructose from any kind of fruit. And Gary Tobe's book, The Case Against Sugar, doesn't encourage huge amounts of fruit either. And I don't think Bittman does as well.
And you know, I should have said that, because there are a lot of high carbohydrate vegetables. We can use the squashes, the spaghetti squash, the butternut squash, the acorn and the Hubbard squash as our carbohydrates as well.
Mm-hmm. And what about the legumes, like lentils, chickpeas?
Yes.
We can have that.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Teresa, this is Bitten. Teresa, this is wonderful. I love this. Cynthia asked my question, but I have another one. We're very careful with fruits, too, because a lot of people binge on it. But
yes.
I was asking you, I agree with you on the high fructose corn syrup. I think that is worse than cocaine. But on the new list you're working on, have you seen that the makers of all the junk food, have they started to use different name to confuse us?
Yes, they're using corn syrup, corn sweeteners.
Oh, okay. And other name too? Because there's a lot of strange chemical names on products in Sweden now. And I suspect that it is high fructose corn syrup, but you know, you can't see that on the label.
Oh, Bitten, send me a list.
Absolutely.
And I'll send it to the high fructose corn syrup people and ask them.
Okay, good, good. Thank you. That was my question.
Teresa, I have a question. It's Lior. When I was in treatment at Glen Bay in the late 80s, they told us to use decaf coffee and not regular caffeinated coffee, because they specifically said that caffeine will cause cravings. And you're saying now that the decaf can actually be the one that does create the cravings. So can you talk a little bit about that? And I mean, I'm sure things have changed. 1988 was a long time ago, so I'm sure there's more information now. But I'm still with that. You know, I was indoctrinated at Glen Bay, and I still follow a lot of the stuff that I was taught there. So I was interested to hear your take on that.
Do you know my friend Phil Riddell?
No, I don't. I don't. I was from the time when oh my God, what was his name? Fred. Fred was around, and I was in Miami.
Okay.
Fred and Donna, and that was when I was there when they first opened.
Phil tells a story of putting down caffeine and drinking 10 cup pots of decaf. He had to put down caffeine. If you can drink one or two cups of real coffee a day, that's fine. If you can't, and if it causes you cravings, put it down. But what my point was is, the withdrawal from caffeine and the withdrawal from sugar and other foods can sometimes be too hard for people to manage if they're not physically in a safe place. And it's better to leave a reasonable amount of caffeine in while you withdraw from the other foods and then withdraw from the caffeine. And how I recommend people withdrawing from the caffeine is using 3/4 cup of caffeine and 1/4 cup of decaf, and then for several days, and then half caffeine and half decaf, and then 3/4 decaf and 1/4 caffeine until you get yourself off the stuff. But if you can have 1 cup of coffee a day and not trigger your cravings or your obsessions, I don't think it's wrong to have a cup or two of coffee a day. You know, we can cut out everything in our lives and give ourselves a food plan that is so hard to follow that we can't follow it, and then we relapse, and then it's worse. I'd rather cut out those foods that trigger your cravings and obsessions and leave in everything I can. I don't know what they were doing in 1988 and 1989, Lior, but the best knowledge that I have now is that a lot of the decaf is having a synthetic caffeine in it, and so is diet soda and other products and the energy drinks. And that caffeine is more powerful and more triggering than the regular caffeine. That's why it's more of a problem.
Teresa, I read somewhere that the decaf, the way they have to process the decaf today is so toxic.
Yes.
And I also read that it has to do with your shape of your liver. I don't mean the physical shape. I mean, you know, what kind of condition your liver is in. Because it seems like some people with a very good functioning liver can do the half breakdown of coffee much faster than other people. And the one that have a, like if you take Tylenol or something like that, you know, and your liver is down, you're going to have a hard time processing decaf and some people coffee too. But I think you may experience too that black coffee in small amounts, a lot of people can handle.
Yes.
But decaf seem to have some kind of toxic ingredient.
Yes.
Yeah.
I just posted in the chat a reference for dementia and Alzheimer's and caffeine, that caffeine has a positive effect, just a few cups a day, as you've mentioned, one or two, for people that have dementia and Alzheimer's or want to avoid that. So as people are aging, it may be beneficial rather than negative, but again, in small quantities. The flavored coffees are things that very often have something really toxic in it that creates cravings. So to really watch out.
We don't want flavored coffee. Okay, moving right along. This is what we've been talking about. Take out all the individual's personal drug and trigger foods. That's the first and most essential thing. Ask the person to give you a binge food list. When you're binging and really doing good at it, what are you eating? And then take the list in the previous slide and say, which are the foods? Is it a sugar and fat, or is it sugar, fat, and flour, or is it sugar and chocolate, or is it fat and chocolate, or what is it? And listen to the binge food list and start with that one where the person tells you, when I can't stop and I'm really desperate and I'm eating everything that's not nailed down and doesn't bite back, what are they eating? Start with that list and take out those foods, and then take out all the foods that are the horse they came in on. If potato chips are a problem, veggie chips and lentil chips are going to be a problem too. Take out the foods that look and taste and smell like the binge foods. So my client who binges on French fries can't have waffle fries. Now, I know that in America, French fries, when they're cut, are dipped in sugar water before they're fried. So the next question is, can she have fries that she makes by herself? And the answer to that is probably not. But can I let her do sweet potatoes in the oven with pumpkin pie spice on it? And big chunks? Maybe. Not all of these foods need to be eliminated by everyone. If you look in AA and NA, they are really clear that you run your own program. If I look in OA, I often have problems with people who come to me to say that this person said I shouldn't use this food, and it's not a problem for me. What shall I do? If a food is not a problem for a person, let them keep it until and unless it becomes a problem. Choose the foods that are problems, and a problem means it causes cravings and obsession and binge behavior. And add to that the foods that are similar either by their ingredients or their design, like white flour, like split pea chips. Split pea chips sound so nice, but what they do to make split peas, I mean, think about a split pea and think about a split pea chip. What I had to do to get to a split pea chip is I had to grind it into a flour and then form it into the chip, right? And that grinding the split pea into the flour makes the carbohydrate in the flour be absorbed so much more rapidly that I'm triggering the person, even though it's not white wheat flour, it's white flour. So I want to pull out the split pea chips and the lentil chips and the veggie chips and the potato chips because I want to pull out all of the products that the person is sensitive to so that they can get freedom from the craving and obsession, and then they can work their recovery program. Principle number two, again, this is so important to me. A diet is a period of starvation that happens right before you gain 20 pounds. A food plan is a comfortable way of eating. You want to have enough food at the time of day that you need it. This client is going to be hungry 10 minutes before a meal, and he or she is going to be satisfied at the end of the meal, or I'm going to change their food plan. I want the person to eat within 2 hours of getting up and every 3 to 5 hours after that. Because one of the things that creates a binge is when the person feels this rapid drop in blood sugar levels. That is misinterpreted often by a person as a binge, as the urge to binge or as a craving to binge. So I want the person to not have that rapid drop. If I'm working with a person, for example, a nurse who works from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m., their food plan is going to be different from a person who works from 9 to 4. And it's still going to be different from my little old 80-year-old lady who doesn't get to get out of bed and get to breakfast until 10 o'clock. She might eat only 3 times a day, and my nurse who works round the clock might eat 7 times in those 24 hours, and then when she's off, she might eat only 4 or 5 times. And we have to set up a food plan that fits that. But the principle is, I want to provide food within 2 hours of getting up and every 3 to 5 hours after that. And I want to refocus the person on how to take care of themselves with food. Usually, people who come to me are in a war with food. And I want them to come to peace with food. I want a peace treaty. I want the freedom from the craving and the obsession and the struggle with food so that we can go through steps 4 through 9. Because do you remember in 1937 or 38, I don't know if they taught you this in this class, But alcoholics used to think that if they didn't get through steps 4 through 9 in the first year of recovery, they were going to relapse. And it's my experience that the people who've been in LA for 20 years and can't stay abstinent are on a restrictive food plan and are not doing a 12-step recovery program. And so I think it's really important to get the food plan safe enough and comfortable enough that the person can then go create a joyful, useful life. Number 3 is the most important thing to me. I want nutrients. I want the body to be fed in a way that makes the body feel clean and strong. If the body is hungry, the body is going to cooperate with your every desire to binge. I want to provide B vitamins and minerals and calcium, and I'll tell you a personal story. In 2001, I had a surgery for scoliosis. I had rods and screws put in 14 vertebrae of my spine. In 2010, I had an auto accident, and I was in pain 24/7 until 2013, when I went to a doctor at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, and he said, I will fix your back, but it is a huge surgery, and why do you want this? And I told him, because I want to be me and be here with you. And he said, okay, but you're 67 years old, and we have to do a DEXA scan to see if there's enough calcium in your bones. Because if there's not enough calcium in your bones to hold the rods and screws I'm going to put in your spine, you won't be able to have the surgery, and you will be in a wheelchair. So I was terrified. And then he told me he was going to Egypt to visit his family for 6 weeks. And then I cried. And then the nurse practitioner said, you have them send the DEXA scan to me, and I will call you. And the DEXA scan came through, and she called me, and she said, don't worry about it, Teresa. He's not going to object to this. And when he called me, he said, at your age, how come you have such good bones? And my response is, because I eat my vegetables. But the truth is, because I'm rigorous about getting enough calcium and B vitamins. And it's really important that we provide high nutrient, whole, unrefined, and unprocessed foods. Sugar pulls B vitamins out of the body and can create B vitamin deficiencies. When I have a client who has a sugar addiction that's heavy duty, I ask them to take a B vitamin supplement for 90 days. When I worked in a drug and alcohol rehab at one point, we used to give the alcoholics, we were dealing with street people. They were not people who had normal diets. But we used to give them 100 times the recommended daily allowance of B vitamins. And we used to tell them that when your body has excess of B vitamins, your urine is going to turn bright yellow, neon yellow. And we used to ask them to tell us when their urine turned neon yellow. And sometimes it took 6 weeks for the body to replenish itself. So when you have a client who is a sugar addict particularly, or when you suspect and you're looking at this person and their skin is dry and their hair has fallen out and they're exhausted and they're feeling miserable, I want you to consider using a B vitamin supplement or a B vitamin and mineral supplement or a general vitamin supplement. 100% of the recommended daily allowance of the B vitamins of the United States is set up to be the amount that keeps you from having a deficiency disease. I want you to have more than that. I want my clients to have between 10 and 25 milligrams of B vitamins, and I want them to have a list of minerals that goes from here around the whole bottle so that we know that we're getting a little bit of everything in the supplement. And I regularly suggest that a person who's been doing this and just starting, or a person who's coming out of a 3-month relapse, take a B vitamin, because I think it helps them strengthen themselves and replenish their body's nutrients so that they can feel strong and comfortable. Principle number four.
Theresa?
Yes?
We're on the top of the hour, so I'm thinking if we should take like this 3 minutes?
Absolutely.
Yeah, just to for people for restroom and drink or something. Hopefully not too much caffeine or soda or something.
Okay, we'll be back in 3 minutes.
Synthetic caffeine in.
I'm getting coffee.
Yeah. Just take a few. I'll be back.
Theresa, are you there? Are you taking a break?
I'm taking a break. I'll be right back.
Okay.
Alrighty, my dear, I'm back.
Okay, so let's just start again, Theresa, since you're back. People will be hearing it, I'm sure.
Okay.
So just, can I make ask a quick question about vitamin D,
mm-hmm.
which has been so much talked about, and I know with vitamins and minerals and all of that, that was one of the things that I tried so desperately to use before I got abstinent from sugar and starches and stuff. And I could never really feel a difference if I was taking a supplement or not. But once I got abstinent, I started really getting the benefits of taking different like vitamin Bs and stuff. But I never felt it so dramatically as when I started using the vitamin D. And, you know, my mood just lifted in a way I would have never thought. And I always take large doses of it, or at least periodically. So just a comment from you maybe on the vitamin D.
We are discovering more and more how much we need of vitamin D. It used to be that the Americans were supposed to have 400 international units. Now they're saying 800 to 1,000. And most people who know what they're doing say 2,000.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because we're not out of doors enough to get sunshine enough. And in Iceland, you don't get enough sunshine.
Mm. That is true. So true. Yeah.
In Sweden, we say 5,000. Between middle of September to middle of April, mm-hmm. the way, you know, our climate up here.
Right.
Absolutely.
Theresa, question. Someone who is diagnosed with osteoporosis and doesn't eat any dairy because it's a trigger, What would you suggest?
I want them to take 1,500 milligrams of calcium a day. with 750 milligrams of magnesium so they don't get constipated, and with at least 2,000 international units of vitamin D.
And is there any particular kind of calcium? Because it comes as calcium citrate and it comes as calcium. I don't remember the different forms, but...
No particular form. But I'll tell you how to know if it's going to be absorbed. Take a tablespoon of vinegar and put it in a cup. Fill the cup with water and put one pill in the cup. Tomorrow morning, look at if that pill has dissolved. You should have a mush at the bottom of the cup. If you don't, then that pill is not going to dissolve in your GI tract. That's how you know. Mm-hmm.
Just can you tell me again what amount you were talking about calcium? How much was that?
A tablespoon of vinegar?
No, I mean the calcium.
1,500 milligrams of calcium.
Calcium, yeah. And what was the other thing?
750 of magnesium.
Yeah. And vitamin D.
2,000 of D. And that's for someone who has osteoporosis. If they don't, anywhere from 1,000 to 1,500 is fine. And anywhere from about half the amount of vitamin D, of magnesium, is appropriate.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
This is Sherry. I had a question that people who are eliminating dairy often drink nut milk, like almond milk, or there's all kinds of different milks or coconut milk, unsweetened. But when I look at the, it has a lot of calcium, but it otherwise it's mainly, if I recall, fat. Is there a value in that?
There's not a problem in that.
Okay. But is it mainly to, to replace, you know, because like Glenbay and all the treatment centers back then had a dairy serving apart from protein for breakfast and typically for, you know, a snack, metabolic adjustment.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why I, so is it sort of to provide some, is it more for the body or for the mind?
It's more for having something to put on your cereal. It's more for having something to mix with your fruit. It's more for the emotional comfort of that rather than for any nutrient problem, as near as I can tell.
Okay.
And there are exceptions. Okay, moving right along here. I do not want you to eat fruit by itself. I would dare you to find a client for whom I've written a food plan that has fruit by itself. I want you to have a balance of protein and fat with all carbohydrate. And I want to distribute the carbohydrate and protein evenly through the day. And I want to consider their daily life and their energy needs. And I want to provide protein source with all carbohydrate source. Now, regular milk gets half its protein, half its calories from protein, and half its calories from carbohydrate. All the other foods have some protein and some fiber, and that's fine. Fruit gets 100% of its calories from fructose. If you eat a piece of fruit at 3 o'clock because you're hungry, you're going to feel more full because of the fiber in the fruit. But the fructose in that fruit is going to be rapidly absorbed and sent to the liver, It's going to be turned into glucose and some other products, and it's going to be released into your bloodstream in 60 to 90 minutes. And what I want is for you to have the fruit with some other protein so that you slow down how rapidly that fruit sugar is absorbed, so that you slow down the liver's release of that fructose into the bloodstream. And I want you to be careful about the amount of fat. The more I've worked with people, the more I've noticed that if you don't get enough fat, I will tell you what happens. The skin gets dry, the hair gets dry and brittle and falls out, the nails get brittle and break, the fatigue level is enormous, and the libido lives in Texas. I hope there's nobody on this call from Texas. But my point to you is, we need to get 20 to 30% of our calories coming from fat. And the other thing I've noticed is that fat is what tells your body to, that it's safe, that you're not starving. Fat tells your body to back off and relax. And so I've noticed that the more people are careful about getting the fat that they need, the more easy it becomes for them to stay abstinent. So I, at this point, rarely ask for less than 15 grams of added fat at lunch and at dinner. I find that when I do that 15 grams or more of added fat at lunch and dinner, in addition to the fat that you get from the other foods you eat, this makes a big difference in people's lives.
Why don't you add that to breakfast? It's Mary here.
Oh, sorry.
I do if the person wants it at breakfast.
Theresa, when you say 15 grams of fat, what does that relate to in teaspoons, tablespoons, or whatever? If
you're a tablespoon of olive oil.
One tablespoon?
Uh-huh.
Thank you.
A tablespoon of butter or margarine, an ounce of avocado. Not a hard amount to add.
It's a 0.5 ounce. It's a 0.5 ounce. The 15 grams.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, you have.
Sorry.
Okay.
Essentially 5 grams per teaspoon.
Yes.
And what about nuts? Are they considered as a crunchy food, so they are trigger foods, or we can add them to food for lunch and dinner if we don't want to add oil?
Yes.
So nuts are okay?
If they are not a trigger food for you.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. The highest protein nuts are pistachios and peanuts, almonds, and soy nuts. And so many people who are vegetarian choose to use them as protein instead, but that's fine too. Principle number 5 is enough food. I want enough fluid. Water is absolutely essential to your survival. Seltzer is fine, flavored but unsweetened. Herbal tea or iced tea is fine. And teach the client how to know she is drinking enough. How does the client know she's drinking enough? Does anybody know?
From the urine? From the urine color?
Exactly. From the urine color. If the urine is a brownish, darkish tinge, that's not enough water. The urine needs to be a light straw color. And if it's not, she needs to drink more. And I set up a structure for people to drink more fluids. And the other thing I just discovered, I had a client who was hospitalized with severe constipation, and her stool was dry and hard, and she was in the hospital for 3 days, and they took her out, and she went back to her doctor, and lo and behold, she had been abstinent for 3 months, and she'd been on a blood pressure medicine that had a diuretic. So the more weight she lost and the more abstinent she became, the lower her blood pressure and the lower the fluid in her body became. And so that became a real difficult thing, and they had to take her off her diuretic. So when you have a problem with fluid and clients, you want to double check the dietetics, or the diuretic, sorry. In addition, I want to be careful that the client's going to lose weight. I want to be careful that she's going to gain weight if she needs to. I want to increase her protein, because protein, you know, having enough protein is the most important thing for a food addict. The protein is what slows down the absorption of the other things, because protein comes with fat, and protein and fat slow down the absorption of carbohydrate so that you don't get that blood sugar swing and you don't feel like you want to eat everything that's not nailed down. The next thing is I look at skin and hair and nails and energy and their periods and their libido. There's a reason why these things are important. The body considers skin and hair and nails optional services. So those are the first things the body turns off. So if the skin and hair and the nails and the energy and the menses of the libido are not right, then I want to look at why. Is there a nutritional component or is this a medical component? We have to look at that, because if we don't look at that and we don't take care of that, then the person is not going to stay abstinent in addition to having all these other problems. So we have to be really careful about that. And the last thing on this list is please make the meals and snacks fit the client's life and lifestyle comfortably. So for instance, I have a client who gets her breakfast at 7:30 and gets her lunch, and she's required at work to eat lunch at 11:30. That's fine. But her dinner is very odd. She has a 5:30 meeting she could go to, but then she wouldn't get dinner till 7:30. And it feels like to go home and eat dinner at 4:30, she can't do that because she doesn't have time. So I want to put a metabolic in at 4:30 so that she can go to her meeting and then go home and eat a late dinner. And the next person who goes to her meeting at 7:30 is going to go home and eat her dinner at 5 or 5:30 and be fine. But then she's going to want something else after dinner because she's going to get up at a later hour of the morning. So arrange meals and snacks to fit the life and lifestyle comfortably, and that makes it easier for the person to follow the food plan rather than struggle. And the last point is, and I know I've noticed this before, is that abstinence is more than a food plan. This is not about following the food plan for the rest of your life. This is about getting the food far enough out of the way that you can create the life you want. Abstinence is the first step, and the food plan is the first step in abstinence. And once the abstinence is established, then recovery starts. And then you can work on all these other things. But until and unless you do that and get a serious, stable abstinence, the person can't work on a recovery plan. Now, I believe that the abstinence can change. If a person is going to tell me they're only willing to put this down and they're not willing to look at that, I'm going to let them do that until they come to the point of knowing that looking at that is essential. And then I'm going to work on that piece with them. And then I'm going to move them through their abstinence. If a woman becomes, for instance, pregnant, her food plan has to change through her pregnancy. And then when she's breastfeeding, well, for instance, you need 1,000 calories of food to make 600 calories of breast milk, and a newborn baby uses 50 calories per kilo of body weight. So I have to add that into the food plan so that the person is not so hungry and so that she has enough breast milk to feed the baby. So the food plan is not something that you lock yourself into like a straitjacket. The food plan is your favorite pair of sneakers or that favorite sweater that you reach for when you come home and you're tired, or that you just absolutely love. This is what the food plan is supposed to be. It's not supposed to be a food plan that feels like what my daughter calls hooker heels. Do you know what hooker heels are? They're those 4.5-inch high things that you feel like you're going to wobble on. David's not going to relate to this too much, but it's the 4.5-inch high heels that you feel like you're going to wobble for the whole night. I don't want the food plan to feel like that. I want the food plan to feel like a comfortable pair of sneakers that you can go hiking through your life in. There's a sentence I love. It's that abstinence is a state of mind characterized by freedom from the obsession with food. And I think that's really important, to move the person into that state of freedom from the obsession with food, and then let them go on and eat and live abstinently and do their recovery program. And doing the recovery program is what keeps them from needing to eat food. Someone today said, I wouldn't risk it. I have a friend who's an alcoholic, and someone whined at her in a restaurant about, why don't you just have the veal marsala, the alcohol cooks off. And she said to me, I would never risk it, because I wouldn't want to risk having to go through that stuff again. I don't want that kind of life. And that's what's really important. Recovery is the process of emotional and spiritual growth that lasts lifelong. My first 12-step program was 1973, and my last 12-step meeting was last night. It's something that you do for the rest of your life. And the recovery process removes your obsessive relationships and leads you to peace and leads you to emotional and spiritual growth. And that transformation is what brings the client to peace with the food and the eating behaviors. And that's what you want, is you want to get your client to peace with food and eating behaviors and the rest of your life. And yes, I think I've talked about the food plan needing to change as recovery progresses. And I think that's all I prepared to say. So now we have plenty of time for your questions.
Teresa, I have two questions. First, I want to say thank you. This has been quite like the best presentation I've ever heard on food plans. So I really want to thank you for that. I've learned so much. You mentioned
thank that. You,
your clients should only feel hungry 10 minutes before a meal. What about false hunger? How do you identify it? How do you help people work through it?
Well, what is false hunger?
Say that again.
What is false hunger?
So I think it's, especially when you're trying to get off the food, and I know I still experience it too at night, because nighttime was a big binge time for me. And so I put my daughter to bed at 7:30, and then I'm like, ooh, I'm hungry, but I know I'm not. Dinner was an hour ago, but my body is telling me I'm hungry. So there's something, I feel like it's false hunger. It's a memory of a time when I would binge in the evening.
Uh-huh. And where in your body is the hunger? Is the first question I ask a client.
It kind of feels like it's in my stomach, but then I think about it and I'm like, dinner was an hour and a half ago. And then when I really start thinking about it, it goes away.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what you need is a ritual for after you put your daughter to bed.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do after you put your daughter to bed?
Sometimes I go back to work, email, read, watch television, but maybe I could do something related to program. I could maybe listen to a tape or change it up a little.
Or maybe you could do something spiritual.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Or maybe you could do something you enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you enjoy. My two favorite addictions are silly novels and yarn and knitting. Mm. I probably have enough yarn in my house to open a yarn shop. Mm-hmm. And there is the saying that she who dies with the most yarn wins. I'm in a contest for that. But my point is that what you're saying that you're doing after your daughter in bed is in bed does not sound like pleasure to me.
No, no. I usually think it's a time to get back to work. I see what you're saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So no wonder my mind goes, well, you know what? Binging's way more fun than work.
Yes, it is. And I want you to find something else that's way more fun than work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really great idea. Thank you. My second question is, are we allowed to use any of these slides if we give you credit for them?
Yes. What else?
Teresa, excellent lecture. I love every minute of it. I can really hear that you have a long time and experience in this field.
Thank you.
I think about what Dima said about false hunger and the difference between, you know, craving in the beginning, like during the first weeks when, you know, they're detoxing.
Yes.
What kind of tricks up your sleeve do you have to deal with cravings? Because, you know, they're not still stable. I mean, they have blood sugar, volatile blood sugar. I mean, you know, the stress, the withdrawal. So many of them have cue-induced or stress-induced cravings.
Actually, Helga and I are working on something, I think. I think she agreed to do it with me yesterday. I sent her a withdrawal list that I have come up with that is a list of the withdrawal symptoms that goes on for a month. Now, if you give that to a client and tell the client you're going to have withdrawal, and having withdrawal is proof that you have a physical addiction. What that does is it takes away their guilt. It gives them permission to take away the guilt and the shame. I see, Bitten, you wear glasses. Why you wear glasses is because your eyes are shaped differently from the way they're supposed to be so you can see better. And the food addict's brain is shaped differently and functions differently from the way a non-food addict's brain functions. And they have to hear that. And withdrawal demonstrates that their brain isn't working the way it's supposed to work. And that's why you want that to be a thing that you teach them. And I'm hoping that Esther Helga and I can write a better food withdrawal thing that we write to, and we combine our information together so that
I sent you the one I use.
Really? Well, you might have sent me one, but then I only received one and it was not in English, so.
Yeah, I'm translating it right now.
Well, can you translate that then?
Yeah.
We'll work on this and we'll set up a better thing of withdrawal.
Good.
And then, because I based mine on a number of my clients and on a man who teaches relapse prevention in the United States. And so we looked at those things that were common. And so if you tell them that this is what's going to happen, they will know. And the other thing is teach them to pray now. Use these cravings to teach them to pray. Teach them to move themselves into a book, a meditation, a journal, a piece of step work that when they have those cravings, they need to write down what's going on for them before they are allowed to eat. And that way you teach them to pray instead of eat and you get some click of what's going on for them. I had a client who gets up in the middle of the night and eats ice cream. And we went round about this for a long time. And then she finally rubber banded a pencil and 3x5 cards to the ice cream container. And she told herself she couldn't eat the ice cream until she wrote down what was going on in the middle of the night.
And after 2 weeks, she called me to say, now I know what I need to do. Send me to someone who can help me with this. So that craving that was coming up for her in the middle of the night was the real problem that was driving her addiction. And so when she solved that real problem, then the craving to get up in the middle of the night diminished. Okay?
Theresa, thank you. Could you talk some about three things? One is codependency, one is trauma, and one is that addicts, alcoholics and drug addicts who lose weight and experience the same kinds of withdrawal symptoms that they had from the previous drug and alcohol intake years and years before. And if you've seen that kind of experience. Another fellow and I shared notes about that. And I have some withdrawal symptoms I'll share too.
Please share the withdrawal symptoms in here.
I will.
Why are there chocolate chip cookies at AA meetings? Because in the beginning, in AA, they said, if you are having a craving, get some sugar on board. Because alcohol is fermented sugar. So in 1936, if you wanted sugar, you walked down to the center of town to the candy shop and you bought it, and it came in a little white bag, just like prescriptions come in the United States today. And the man put it on top of the refrigerator, and nobody dared touch daddy's peppermints because God forbid daddy should have a craving and go back to drinking, and because there were no peppermints there. So they teach it AA to get some sugar on board when you're having a craving, because sugar will take away the alcohol craving. Now when we put down the sugar, the alcoholic is going to have those cravings, and he's going to need to use other tools to work through them. Yeah, that's true. Now I forgot your other two questions.
About trauma and about codependency as triggers.
Oh, trauma. I found a therapist who's a trauma specialist. She and I are doing a 3-day weekend at the end of March, because trauma is one of the biggest problems that happens that leads people into food. First off, the little kid who's being abused is then given ice cream by the abuser to calm them down and so forth. And they do the abuse to get the ice cream. And they learn that they need to use food to ameliorate those feelings about trauma. It's terrible. And then the diets that we've been on, having people tell you what to eat and doing your very best and not being able to follow the food plan that someone else gave you for 25 years, and having that happen to you over and over again, that's a trauma. And yeah, we need trauma therapists to deal with that. I send people for EMDR and somatic experiencing so that they can be relieved of the trauma of the diets that they've been on, and the trauma of the stigma that there is in America against overweight and obese people, and the trauma of people. Someone was in the newspaper this morning. It was a woman at a cashier at a checkout was asked, the woman who wrote in, how many months pregnant are you? And she wasn't pregnant, and she was deeply hurt. And this is a trauma that will stay with her long term. Yeah. It's terrible. And what did you want me to tell you about trauma?
No, it was just that so many people seem to me to pick up, they get hooked with the food, but mm-hmm. It's got a trauma hook attached to. So
you have
codependency as well.
Yeah.
Thank you.
One of my, the techniques that I was, taught when you wake up in the middle of the night with a traumatic dream is to take, who do you want to take with you? Your father, your husband, your therapist, your sponsor, Michael the Archangel, a whole bevy of angels, whoever you think of as your higher power, and go back into that dream at night and resolve the dream in your favor and move out of it. And that was a technique that many people have used that has helped them move away from that trauma in, because you can do it in your mind in a few minutes and move away from that and move away from that and distract yourself from the need to eat food over the trauma. But it's terrible. I think codependency is worse than food addiction or alcoholism or drug addiction, because the disease is in your mind. It's my desire, my value as a person is dependent on whether you like this program or not. That's a major codependent issue. And I haven't yet met a food addict who wasn't codependent. So these codependency issues have to be taken care of too. Mm-hmm. I'm doing a program in May on that too.
I just wanted to add to that, Theresa, that when I talk about the two, the codependency and food addiction as a twin disease.
Absolutely.
And I hear you with the trauma and the, you know, the something happens and a child gets food to comfort it, and you know, this is why I learned and studied, and I'm working with hypnotherapy. EMDR is great, and I use regression and parts therapy in awake and down under hypnotherapy with very good results also. So
wonderful.
Yeah, just to get that in there. Uh-huh. Even guide, place, actually.
Acupuncture works too.
Two things I wanted to say. One of the things with trauma is that the person needs to feel safe. And if we can help them understand Daniel Siegel's Try and Brain model, you know, they can experience in Hakomi to work with themselves, at least to create a safe place for themselves to get through a tough spot. Not that that means no therapy, because yes, therapy is needed. So that's just one comment. The other thing that I wanted to talk about, the brain being plastic and fibers being able to grow and you know, healing happen, and so using whether it's mindfulness or any kind of meditation process, do you think that there can be that kind of change or repair in the brain of the food addict that can help long-term abstinence and long-term recovery by using some of these techniques and using the plasticity, if you can call it that, the plasticity of the brain?
Yes, I do, absolutely. Yes, I do, absolutely. But the addiction never leaves, really. And one of the things that we know about addiction is that there are some positive pieces here. Persistence is one of them. Perfectionism is another one of them. If we can pull it back to having high standards, we can use that piece of the mind to make sure that there are no spelling errors in the PowerPoints I just sent you. Can we use the intuitive, creative part of the addiction in other places in our lives? It's a question. Meditation and prayer are absolutely essential. I don't know anyone who achieves long-term recovery without use of a higher power. If you know someone who can maintain a long-term recovery and live a joyful, useful life without a relationship with a higher power, please send them to me. I want to know how they did it. And if you find anyone who can find freedom from food obsession and a joyful, happy life, that's the critical, important piece, a joyful, happy life, without the help of other people, please send them to me. I want to know how they do it. What else would you like to know? We have a few more minutes.
So I'm thinking, Theresa, like, you know, with the different foods and the difficulty that I face, like here in Iceland, is that there's no dietitian, nutritionist that has the knowledge to work with food addiction. So I have had to step up and learn to help people in that way. And I know I've bought some of your stuff and listened to you. You've assisted me in many ways. And me, of course, I come from Gray Sheet, which is it's a very square program where, you know, we take almost not all grains out. It's a relatively low carbohydrate diet, and it's the only thing that has given me a total freedom, and it is the total freedom that I feel is maybe my strongest gift into the explaining my recovery to people, in order for me, when I can say, you know, no matter what is happening in my life, you know, I never have to eat. It's not in the same hand. My emotions and my food is never in the same hand, and I never clap them. So, which is a saying in 12 steps. So maybe my question is, what kind of freedom from food are we wanting a person to have? And just to, for a person, for a client to know that this kind of a freedom is the goal. And on the way, of course, you know, we need to, and I do what you do, you know, I listen to the client and I go to the client and take their hand, and together we walk into recovery, hopefully, you know. But I think a lot of people get stuck somewhere on the road not quite the freedom that I'm talking about, you know. And they're just happy with it, with whatever they have, because it's better than what they had. So how would you address that in your practice?
Well, you've addressed five different things. First off, I have clients in 44 states and five different countries. And if you have someone who really needs help, please be welcome to let me do a phone session with them.
Absolutely.
Secondly, I'm writing a food plan book. I've been out of work for the last 4 months because of an ankle surgery. And I've been rewriting the food plan book. So the food plan book will be available in the next couple of months, so you can use that to help you with the people you're working with. Thirdly, I'm doing, I have a constant contact email that people can sign up for off the website, and I'm doing blogs about different ways to handle different situations. So you can refer to that and use the information from there. But your real question is, how do you get to real peace and freedom? Well, if you aim at nothing, you're going to hit it. So your example of real peace and freedom is the most important thing you give them. And you ask them not to stop until they get to real peace and freedom. And you assess, or I assess, where are they? Is it the spirituality? Is it what physical activity is going on in their life? Are they getting enough sleep? Are they exercising? Are they doing rewarding things in their life? Do they need to make changes in the food plan? Where is the, is it spirituality? Is it rest? Is it exercise? Is it food plan? Where is it? Is it physical, mental, emotional, or spiritual that has them stuck? And move them into the place of working on that piece. I think the spirituality is the hardest part for people to get, because most of the time, food addicts have prayed about their food while they've been eating it, God help me to keep it all. Don't let me eat the rest of this ice cream. And it didn't work for them, so they don't trust. Or I was raised with the Catholic Church God, who was a dude in flowing white robes with a big beard and a big black book where he wrote down everything I did wrong. And that's not the kind of God that will work for me. So I have to reach for wherever it is, where is the place that is going wrong? And if I can't find it, then I ask the client to write a letter to God every night from now until our next session, saying, would you please show me which part is wrong? And by the time they come to me, they know. Or I ask them to write what's going on, 5 sentences about what's going on before they eat off the food plan. And just hold that until, and bring all those cards with them to me. And we go through them until we figure out what is the real problem that's keeping them from getting the, what they really, really want in their lives. Does that answer your question?
Absolutely. And I also wanted to comment on, because you're talking about spirituality, and I'm totally with you there. But when I started, I needed to have something more simple, like, I don't know what the heck my higher power is. and I have something like that. But I think it's for people that come from the professional side into this kind of studying, It's very important for me and for them, I think, to know that a higher power is basically somebody outside of yourself that can help, whatever that is, and whoever that is. You agree with me?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's a starting point, and I know a lot of professionals may be hesitant in talking about prayer, and then I talk about what about the word asking. Asking for instead of praying for, ask for. And so just trying to get vocabulary out there that people can deal with.
Different words help. Great Spirit, yeah. The universe. Yeah. There's this Ask and It Is Given by Esther Hicks that Wayne Dyer has put out a lot of things about healing, but I ask them if they're the most powerful force in the universe. Is a hurricane more powerful or less powerful than you? Is a moving train more powerful or less powerful than you? Is food more powerful or less powerful than you? And we get to choose our higher power, and we get to invite a different kind of higher power to come in and help us with the food. For years I used, there's a movie named Oh God, and George Burns played Oh God. I played God in this movie. And it made it very easy to relate to that kind of person. Mm-hmm. So they have to find something they can relate to and invent anything. There are lots of meditation programs on the internet. Deepak Chopra and Oprah Winfrey run one of the most famous ones in the United States. But there are a whole variety of meditation programs that people can use as a beginning. But you're right, professionals don't want to go to spirituality. And I think that it's really important to include that as part of the nature of your own inner core of wisdom. Who are you really? And who do you want to become? Deepak Chopra calls it the observer. When you say, I ate everything that was not nailed down, who is watching, and who felt shitty about it, and who begged you to stop. And when you have a voice in your mind that says, you're fat, stupid, and ugly, who is speaking, because it can't be you, because it's using the pronoun you, who is saying, you're fat, stupid, and ugly? And so beginning to look at those words that we think, I call them automatic negative thoughts. You listen to those thoughts, and you can control them by saying no thank you to them. And I think that's an important piece for all of us who work with addictions to look at. What else?
I have another question. It's Cindy. In the world, there are places where food is not as readily available as in the United States, and different varieties in different seasons and so on. So how do you encourage you, or do you encourage people to have variety of food? And if so, how to obtain that in places where it's less readily available?
Not in the beginning. I want them to have a stable food plan that really, really works for them. They know it works. It works 100% of the time. It always works. I'm having these 10 vegetables. I'm having these 5 fruits. I'm having these 5 meats. This works for me. This is the way it goes. And then when they go to choose to try something else, to try jicama or to try plantain, they can try it, and they know they can go back to a safe place if it doesn't work. And yes, I want them to try the variety of food plans, but I don't want them to move into a place of struggle with it. If we are looking at traveling to a different country, I ask them to look on the internet at the foods that are going to be available and which is going to be appropriate for them to taste and try and which isn't, so that they know before they go what is going to be there and what are they going to be able to eat. What else? Well, you all have my email address, and you're welcome to email me at any time. I'm happy to hear from you. Esther Helga has some handouts. The first handout she has is a sugars handout, and I'm in the middle of revising that, and I'm going to send the revision to her as soon as it's done. We talked about the withdrawal handout, and there's a handout of an article from a place in the United States named Center for Science in the Public Interest, and they wrote an article about whether you can be a food addict. And I frequently give that to people who are questioning whether there's a food addiction, because it explains it clearly enough and unthreateningly enough that people become able to be accepting of that. And the last thing I gave her is just a simple list called Healthy Eating Guidelines, which is basically a summary of the 5 principles that we've had here. And it adds talking to another person about what you're eating. I think it's really important for people with food addiction not to live in a vacuum, but to reach out to others and let other people help them. You're welcome to use those. Please just don't erase the copyrights from them. Please give credit where credit is due. And I'll be in touch with Esther Helga. We'll be rewriting, and Bitten, and we'll be rewriting the withdrawal symptoms chart together. Okay? Esther Helga, do you have anything else you want me to say today?
I was trying to say something before, but I had muted myself. This is me. I am actually thrilled, and I'm just not. I don't think I add anything to what we talked about. I think you've done an excellent job, as I knew you would, and it's just invaluable to have your experience. And What I want to say, what I love about your experience is your spiritual part of it, and the understanding of the two components of the disease, which is the food to be abstinent, and then, the work that needs to be done in order for us to be able to keep the food away. And, it's a question of if we can't say no to food, food is our God, basically. Yes. And we need to find something else to rule our life if we're going to have some sobriety and some peace of mind. And what that is for each person, we'll have to find out.
Well, there's a book that I haven't read, but the title is One Yes Means 1,000 No's.
Ah.
So if I say to recovery, and if I say to a joyful life, that's what I want, then yes, I might have to say no to chocolate chip cookies, and I might have to say no to my mother-in-law.
Yeah, and we need to have, you know, we need to have rules in this life. And we need to grow up and take responsibility. And, you know, that is really what it's all about, is to be able to be responsible for ourselves and mm-hmm. for our eating and for our, you know, good health. And
yes, you do.
Yeah. So
can I add something in? I like to ask Theresa one thing, because when I talk about food addicts, and I am a food addict and someone maybe is a food addict here in Iceland, they all get scared. They don't want to be diagnosed as a food addict. Do you get that experience all the time? Yeah. And
I start by saying to people, it's not, you're a food addict. I say, my body is very sensitive to processed and man-made foods. And I will say to a client, you are so sensitive, processed and man-made foods, that you are. Mm-hmm. And use the word allergic or the word sensitive instead. Mm-hmm. To those who can't understand it.
I agree with the wording is very important, and for some people, you know, very necessary to draw them in. And once they're yes. in, you know, you can do and say everything you need to, you know.
I have a client who said to her mother-in-law, I'm working with this really weird dietitian in Philadelphia, and she will kill me if I do that.
Oh, okay.
And it worked for the mother-in-law, because now she's working with this really weird dietitian in Philadelphia, which is, how did you find a dietitian 2,000 miles away, and et cetera, et cetera. And so that's fine. Whatever excuse you want to use. And another question you can ask people who struggle with you is, why do you want to know that? Mm-hmm. Why is it important to you that I eat this piece of cake or whatever? Mm-hmm. Tell me why.
Another one that I've used either in my mind or in my mouth is, and how does my taking care of me harm you?
Right.
How does my taking care of me harm you?
Exactly.
And they go, what? You know, another thing in terms of someone just said to me recently, oh, well, you must be O positive if you can't eat grains or sugars at all. And I said, no, actually, I'm not. My father was, but I'm not. But that idea that there are some of us who, for whatever reason, go back to those paleo days where the grain had not been able to be digested yet. It couldn't be boiled yet. So it wasn't processed, it wasn't man-made, and it wasn't edible yet.
Right. Right. The body is very sensitive.
And I tell people, I have food allergies, and that keeps them quiet because it's big. They don't have to understand the exact extent of my food addiction. The food allergies, then that makes it like, okay, and it works. It really works.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I have a question, please.
Yeah.
Hello. Yes, Theresa, when you talked about identifying the trigger foods, like if it is fat and sugar or only sugar or fat and sugar and starch, for example, what are the questions that you ask to the person to know that this is a trigger food? Since, as just we said now, that we don't want to tell him that you are a food addict, so we will not ask him what are the addiction foods or the trigger foods. Is there specific or special questions that we can ask? For example, I'm thinking I want to ask to know from someone, what is his trigger foods? What shall I ask him? What is the food that you like the most? What is the food that you crave always? Do you have special questions that you ask?
I don't have special questions that I ask. One of the differences is, are you a dietitian?
Yes.
Okay. So I start with breakfast and say, on a good day, what do you usually eat for breakfast, lunch, dinner, and etc.? And if it's going to be a bad day or a binge day, what is the food like then? And I go through the food hour by hour through the day. What are you eating then? What are you eating then?
Are you feeling like you can't stop eating that food? Are you craving that food? Are you thinking about that food? What are the foods you think about when you're really angry? What are the foods you think about when you're really hurt? What are the foods you feel like you're physically craving? These are important things to look at. And so I just keep asking. And we have something called the DSM-5, which is the Psychiatrist Manual for Psychiatric Disorders. And they have a list of substance use disorders. And they have 11 questions. And I tend to ask the client the 11 questions. And then I show them the list of substance use disorders and agree with them that they've said yes to 12 of the 11 questions. And then I say, you know, you only needed 3. And then I give them articles about food addiction and I ask them to read them and tell me what they think when they're done. I never tell a person they're a food addict. I think that sets up resistance. I ask them, I tell them what food addiction is. I ask them if what they've just told me they're experiencing could fit into the food addiction literature. If you send me your email address, I'll send you something that I wrote for the dietetics practice group in America that did exactly that. And you'll see what I mean. It just follows the substance use dependence lines and gives examples of what people are eating. And so then you can ask them, are you a food addict? And let them read enough and learn enough to say, oh my, maybe that's my problem.
Uh-huh. Okay. Theresa, would you be willing to send it to Esther Helga for all of us to keep? Sure. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So, Theresa, I want to ask you, since you are a dietitian yourself, right?
Yes. Oh, we lost your voice. I can't hear you. No, I can't hear you.
There's something wrong with it. Now you're... Try to unmute yourself again, Dima. No. Something happened to you, the sound. I'm sorry. You want to write the question in the chat? You can do the chat and ask the question, Dima, if you want.
Why is it?
I don't see it.
Theresa, while she's typing, another dietitian question. When you first started in this field, it's Mary and I'm a dietitian as well, what were sort of the biggest resistance you got from your peers as to what you were doing and recommending? Because you have won an award now for being very innovative, but I'm sure it didn't start that way.
I'm still getting resistance from my peers about food addiction's existence. I was in a situation where I had to leave my full-time job for personal reasons, family reasons, and be available for my family. And there was a woman who did aftercare for Glen Bay Hospital of Tampa, Florida. And she asked me to come and speak with her. And she sat me down and I told her what I do. And she said, I have to share with you, you're missing something important. And I knew the minute she told me about food addiction. I had reservations because the body can make sugar from any food you eat. And is this the way you really want to think about it? And she just asked me, I was in a position where I badly needed money. She said, you come and work with me for 6 months. And at the end of that time, you'll have your personal life straightened out. And if you don't believe in food addiction in 6 months, we'll part friends. Mm-hmm. And she set up a situation where she, the therapist, was seeing the client after me. And she asked me just not to argue with the client, just to fix their food with my nutrition knowledge. And I did that, but I listened to the clients and I heard. And you know, there's a saying, you can believe none of what you hear, half of what you read, and all of what you experience. Uh-huh. I couldn't deny my clients' experiences. I couldn't deny that they were feeling and experiencing what they said they were experiencing. And then what really convinced me was withdrawal. I had groups of clients who would have the same withdrawal symptoms, whether I told them they were going to have withdrawal symptoms or whether I didn't tell them they were going to have withdrawal symptoms, they had the same thing. And withdrawal is a symptom of a physical sensitivity. And so I came to believe that food addiction exists. Are there dietitians who don't believe that food addiction exists? Absolutely. I think there are 5 dietitians in the United States. I don't know where you are, Mary, but I think there are 5 dietitians in the United States who really believe and understand that food addiction exists. And 2 of them I trust to work with my clients. The other 3 I don't know well enough.
I'm from Canada, so you might lose those 2 to Canada soon.
Oh, that's terrible.
Now we're adding 1 in Canada. Adding 1 in Canada and 1 in Jordan. So Teresa, the question from Dima is, Teresa, since you are a dietitian, what is the percentage of people that didn't take in the food addiction program and decided to do a normal healthy diet, calories in and calories out? It is not easy for a dietitian to go into food addiction treatment. So
I've tried calories in and calories out with people I think are food addicts. It doesn't work.
Yeah, I
don't know what else to say except it doesn't work. It's not going to work. Uh-huh. If they're eating their binge and drug foods, they're going to binge. Uh-huh. That's all I know. I can't in good conscience recommend calories in and calories out if I know a person is a food addict.
And I think that is going to be our last question at this point. We've, you know, used up both your arms up to your shoulders, Teresa.
I'm glad to be of service.
And I just want to say that you got her, Teresa's email. She's gracious enough to give that to everybody, and I would recommend you contact her and use her services. And also, if there are certain questions, we could do as Vera was suggesting, that you would send me specific questions to address, and I would send them on, so that we would all get the questions and answers, not just individual person getting an answer question answered, but then we would have the opportunity to really all benefit from the questions somebody is asking. Is that okay with you, Teresa, also?
If a person wants an individual answer for themselves, they're welcome to email me. I'm right here on the PowerPoint. If they have a question they're willing to share with the group, I'm absolutely happy for them to send it to you and send it to all of us.
Thank you very much, Teresa, again, for your gracious stay with us here. And I hope you recover well with your leg and all of that, and all your health problems that you're experiencing. And I hope the next time I see you, you'll be walking straight and no problem.
Thank you. I hope so, too.
Thank you, Teresa.
Have a good day, everyone.
Thank you so much, Teresa.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. And I think everybody, we can, I can just end the meeting at this point, and then I will end it for everybody. So people are going to be there in the morning, bright and early, and others next week. And please follow up on material. I did already send you the handouts from Teresa. They should be in the Dropbox and or on the within the posts that I sent from WeTransfer.
And I hope you're having a good time with it. It's an easy thing to just put right into your computer. And now I'm going to be managing the videos for the two sessions now, and I will be putting those on Dropbox, the links on YouTube, and then the links on Dropbox, and then I will also send the videos right on to you, as I did with the others. So,
ciao.
Have a great day or evening. Thank you, everybody, for your patience with the Dropbox and all of that stuff. And we'll just get through all of these things one by one. Okay.